Of all the animals that live on our planet, one extraordinary group dominates. It has produced the largest,
the blue whale,
the fastest, and the most intelligent creatures that have ever lived. They're known as the vertebrates, and they all share one vital feature, a backbone. Now I want to travel back in time to explore their ancient origins and investigate the key advances that led to their amazing success. Advances that can also reveal how we came to acquire the characteristic features of our own vertebrate bodies. Jaws that bite, lungs that breathe, ears that can hear. Because the story of the rise of animals is also the story of how you and I came to be as we are. I will find evidence in a series of spectacular fossil discoveries around the world and within living animals.
There's it.
With the latest scientific analysis, we can bring our ancient ancestors back to life and understand how, over 500 million years, they developed the bodily features needed to master the seas, colonize the land, and take to the skies. This is the story of the rise of animals. The history of life on Earth has been known in outline for many years, but there were a number of tantalizing gaps in it, particularly in the history of animals with backbones. When, for example, did the first signs of a backbone appear? And is it really true that dinosaurs developed feathers and turned into birds? Well, in recent decades, answers have been found to those extraordinary questions. Here in China, and I'm here to look at them. China is the new frontier for fossil discoveries. Excavations here are unearthing links in the story of the vertebrates that have so far eluded us. I have long wanted to see this sensational evidence for myself. I will be traveling to the frozen north of the country and to the capital, Beijing. But to search for the first step in our journey, I'm heading south to Yunnan province. This is the site of a thrilling discovery that has given us new evidence for the very first vertebrates. Excavators here are exposing a rich seam of rocks known as the Chongyang fossil beds. Remarkably, they contain the remains of creatures that once swam in the ancient seas 525 million years ago. Paleontologist Ho Xiangguang was the first to discover the unique features of these beds, an astonishing perfection of preservation.
These mouth parts.
Yeah.
That's very beautiful. You can see it's got striations on it.
To find complete bodies like this is extremely rare. When an animal dies in the sea, normally, bacteria destroy the soft parts very quickly, so that all we can find afterwards are the hard parts, bone or shell. Why that didn't happen here in this particular part of this particular sea is something of a mystery. It may be something to do with the lack of oxygen. But whatever it was, it has given us a privileged view into one of the most exciting chapters in the whole history of life. The beds have so far yielded over 200 separate species. This was a time period known as the Cambrian. The land was still bare and lifeless, but underwater it was exploding into a multitude of forms. The major animal groups we know today were appearing on the planet for the very first time. They built their bodies entirely of soft tissue. Some protected and supported it with a hard outer casing. But none had anything that resembled a backbone. These were the invertebrates. Then Professor Ho and his team found one intriguing exception.
Oh, yes, yes, yes. Yeah.
It's a fossil called Millo Kunmingia. But to examine it in detail, you've got to look at it under the microscope. Its features reveal evidence of a new type of support, not outside the body, but inside. This is one of about 30 specimens that have already been found of this tiny little creature. Under the microscope, it contains extraordinary amount of detail. Those marks are marks that have been made by the excavator's needle. This is the animal itself. This is its head, the top of its back. And nearly every one of them have these two little black spots at the front, eye spots. Looking farther down the animal, there are just some striations here, little bars, which are thought to have been the gill bars, the little constructions that carry blood vessels, which enabled the animal to extract oxygen from the water as it flowed over and breathe. And behind them, farther down the animal, there are these bars, bands of muscle. And they were probably attached to a gristly rod somewhere in the middle there. This is called the notochord, which was the forerunner of the backbone. Millo Kunmingia is the earliest creature we know of that we can truly call a vertebrate. And it seems clear that it used its strong inner rod to move in an entirely new way. As the muscles contract, they bend the rod from side to side. This movement pushes against the water and creates forward thrust. Here was a revolutionary new way to get around. It allowed Millo Kunmingia to roam far and wide and escape the dangerous invertebrate predators that were prowling the seas. The vertebrates would diversify over millions of years to create the spectacular variety of backbone creatures we see today in every environment on the planet. Fish dominate the seas, lakes, and rivers. The amphibians live in both water and land. The reptiles can survive in the driest places on Earth. The birds rule the skies. And the mammals have insulated their bodies to adapt to every climate. We humans have used our greater intelligence to overrun the planet. This astonishing journey was built on a series of key evolutionary steps that helped our ancient ancestors to exploit their environments and overcome huge challenges. The first of these advances was the development of that inner support, the notochord. Back in Europe, you can find a creature that represents the next critical step in our story. It lives unobtrusively and often ignored in British rivers. And it sheds light on the challenges those first vertebrates faced.
Ah, there it is.
This is a lamprey. You might think at first sight that it was a kind of fish, but it's not. It's something much, much more primitive. It has no fins, and even its tail is nothing more than a flattened blade. But what is most remarkable about it is that it doesn't really have a true mouth. Its mouth is just a simple hole with little bristles about it. And it feeds by sucking in water through that mouth and then filtering out little particles of food. So this little animal takes us right back to the time when the first animals with backbones appeared on Earth. It's a true living fossil. The first vertebrates seem to have had the same kind of mouth, and they were almost certainly limited to the same kind of simple food. Over time, other forms evolved with different shapes and sizes, many of them rather larger than Millikonmingia. But all of them had that very simple mouth, an opening at the front of the body, as the lamprey has today. If the early vertebrates were going to really take advantage of the variety of food that was available in those early seas, they were going to have to develop a much more complex and powerful form of eating machinery. Scientists on the east coast of the United States are seeing evidence of this evolutionary advance, not in fossils, but in living creatures. Maine, New England. Marine biologists at the University of New England are studying a group of fish with a very ancient ancestry. They build their skeletons with the same strong material that formed the gristly rod of the first vertebrates, cartilage. They're the sharks, skates, and rays. This group appeared among the vertebrates over 420 million years ago. And that means we can use them to examine the development before that split of a remarkable piece of engineering that changed the course of evolutionary history. The jaw.
If you look back on the evolutionary tree, you'd find that a jaw is a really important feature to have. And it's one of the features that have made skates and sharks apex predators in the environments in which they live.
A jaw hinged to the skull brought the new ability to grab food, then rip or grind it into digestible pieces. But where did this amazing piece of equipment come from? Scientists have found an answer by studying the way living vertebrates develop as embryos. Skates lay their fertilized eggs on the seabed inside leathery cases called mermaids' purses. Scientists can open these up and observe them as they develop, fed by a generous supply of egg yolk. This skate embryo has a simple structure shared by all embryonic vertebrates that served as the basis of the first jaw.
What we see are these folds. And what's really interesting about this is that this skate is in about 4 months of its development. And if we take a close look at another vertebrate, we can see it looks very similar. Here we have the head, and it's going to follow down to the body. You also see the folds. Now this is actually a human being.
It's thought that the embryos of the earliest vertebrates looked much like this, and that each fold developed into a gill. In a skate embryo, the folds furthest from the head keep to their original purpose and form the rigid arches of its gills. But the nearest fold has been adapted to form an upper and lower jaw. In a human embryo, the lower folds develop into structures that include the larynx and the throat. But the top fold, once again, constructs the jaw. The development of the jaw improved the ability to collect food, and those that lacked it, with a few exceptions like the lamprey, died out. But in order to collect food, you have to find it, and that led to an improvement in swimming. In the Chinese capital, Beijing, I've been given special access to a newly identified missing link. This tiny fossil holds clues that are just fragments and hard to spot, but it's the earliest example yet found of a creature with two pairs of fins. It's called Parayunnanolepis, and it's about 410 million years old. Its front part, like many other fish at the time, was covered by armor plating to protect it from predators. Underneath, you can see that it has a mouth. And although the lower jaw is missing, you can tell from marks on the upper jaw that it was once there. But what is most important about this is its fins. Just their stumps are visible. It had two fins at the front, pectoral fins. They were shaped rather like the wings of an aeroplane, and they had the same effect, creating upwards lift through the water. Front fins have been found on older fish. But what is interesting is this is the earliest example which has another pair of fins at the back, the pelvic fins. This second, smaller pair brought much more stability, helping the fish to hold its course through the water. This system was hugely successful, and it made the sharks the skillful swimmers that they are today. So now the vertebrates had jaws and four fins. To see evidence of the next crucial development, I'm heading out onto Lake Fuxian in southern China. These waters are home to living descendants of a group that developed a new kind of inner support, a support that would have huge significance for later life.
Here,
they get a lot of fish, like this. It's a carp. And it's very different from the sharks we've been looking at, because instead of having cartilage skeletons, carp and others like it have skeletons that are strengthened with calcium phosphate. They're bony. And most fish today have bony skeletons. Bone contains the main material found in cartilage, a long stringy protein called collagen. Hard crystals of calcium phosphate add strength. But the collagen can still flex slightly and prevent the bone snapping under pressure. These bony fish could subject their skeletons to the far greater forces that come from increases in speed and agility. They added mobile, fan-shaped fins and assumed a multitude of different forms. From their simple origins over 500 million years ago, the sharks and bony fish diversified to dominate every underwater environment on Earth. There are over 35,000 species alive today. The strong inner bony support to the body had evolved in water, but it would prove most spectacularly successful in a completely new environment. For most of the Earth's history until now, the land had been empty and barren. But around 450 million years ago, first plants, then worms, and then the ancestors of insects began to colonize it. Here were rich pickings for any vertebrate that could reach them. The stage was set for one of the most astonishing leaps in evolutionary history. The vertebrates move onto land. But to achieve this remarkable feat, they would need to make a major modification.
To move around on land without the support of water, these fish needed a way to lift their bodies up from the surface of the ground. They needed limbs.
Scientists have recently found the earliest evidence for this key moment in Eastern Europe. Zahelmia, Poland. Once a quarry for building stone, today this is a hugely significant fossil site. But paleontologist Per Alberg and his team aren't looking for bodies. They're looking for the marks the bodies left behind.
...393 million years ago, this was the soft, muddy floor of a tropical lagoon. You can still see mud cracks here from an episode when the lagoon dried out and the mud all flaked up.
Over millions of years, the mud solidified into layers of rock, which were then tilted by movements in the Earth's crust. By carefully exposing each layer, Per and his team have been able to uncover a series of intriguing tracks.
There are three big dimples in the rock. There's one here, and one down by my feet. These are not erosional hollows. It's not like rock has been scooped away. Something's been pressed into the surface of the mud while it was still soft. You can see that from the internal texture here, but also from the fact that you've got a slightly raised rim around the edge where the mud has been displaced. So a large, heavy animal, presumably a vertebrate of some sort, pushed an appendage into the mud here once, twice, three times in succession.
The marks suggest a creature floating and pushing itself around in the shallows. But Per and his team have found a more detailed set of prints that show an animal doing something even more radical.
this is one of the most important specimens from the entire site. And the reason for that is the pattern that these prints make. You can see easily, I think, that they make pairs, one in front of another, in this kind of diagonal arrangement. In order to be able to produce this, you need to have limbs that stick out to the side and which can be swung forwards and backwards rather freely while you're flexing your body from side to side. Then you can generate this kind of pattern. A fish crawling trace would not look like this.
Another extraordinary slab has even preserved the imprint of what Per believes is a fully formed foot, complete with toes. So how did the vertebrates make this astonishing transition from fish swimming to animals with four legs walking on land? In search of clues, I'm heading to London and the Natural History Museum, home to the largest collection of plant and animal specimens in the world. I'm here to see the remains of an ancient creature once hailed as a missing link that would answer such questions. This is a type of bony fish called a coelacanth. Its fossilized skeletons have been found in rocks even older than those in Poland. Its fins have an intriguing feature not seen in other kinds of fish. Their base is a rounded, fleshy stump that looks tantalizingly like the beginnings of a leg. So scientists thought that this might well be the ancestor of all land-living vertebrates. And then a sensation. A living coelacanth was hauled up from the depths of the Indian Ocean, and the museum has acquired several of them. Here is the body of a baby coelacanth. The coelacanth female retains the egg in her body until it's fully developed. There's its yolk sac, and here's its fin. And you can see this fleshy base to it here, and then its fin rays. The question is, was that strong enough to enable a fish like this to haul itself out of the water and up onto land? Now, living coelacanths have been filmed in the depths of the sea. Its fleshy, muscular fins do certainly help it to maneuver its 5-foot-long body. There is even the hint of a walking pattern. But detailed analysis has revealed that their fins are still a long way from being legs. The ancient coelacanth marked a crucial early stage in that transition, but some characteristics rule it out as a direct ancestor of the land vertebrates. All land-living backboned animals have limbs which have a basic similar bone structure. There is one bone at the top, then there are two bones and a group of bones followed with digits. And the coelacanths didn't have that structure. And then, recently, another fossil discovery was made. Ellesmere Island lies in the icy waters between northern Canada and Greenland. A team of American paleontologists who shot this footage believed that the rocks here were deposited in the right sort of environment for the vertebrates' move to land.
We learned about a sequence of rocks that formed in ancient stream systems, and our hypothesis was that it was in those sorts of environments where limbs were being favored over fins.
The arrival of plants on land had stimulated a surge in life in and around freshwater swamps. And this created new opportunities for the fish that lived here.
One of the niches that was being developed at that time was for shallow water predators. You know, which fish could find other fish that were living in the shallows, the swamps, the productive ecosystems that were just starting to appear on Earth at that time.
Ted Deschler and his colleagues believe that limb-like fins could have helped a fish to hunt in this kind of environment. And then, on the slopes of a barren valley, they made a thrilling discovery.
This was the fossil that got us really excited. We couldn't have dreamed, actually, that we would find something as well-preserved as this one. It's about the front two-thirds or half of the body. As you can see, a very complete skull and a large piece of the body, including parts of the fin.
The team found features that matched the profile of a shallow water predator. Eyes placed on the top of a flattened head. And ranks of sharp teeth. They gave it a local Inuit name, Tiktaalik. We can now work out from its bones how Tiktaalik moved around in those swamps and shallows. In deep water, it must have swum like any other fish. But further examination of its bones showed that it could also move its body in a far more radical way.
One of the really amazing aspects of Tiktaalik that we've noticed is this evolution of the neck. There was not a rigid connection between the skull and the rest of the body. Tiktaalik is the first vertebrate we see that has freed up the neck, and when you think about it, all limbed animals, including ourselves, would not be able to move our head independently of our shoulders if it were not for these innovations that were occurring in a form like Tiktaalik.
A flexible neck allowed Tiktaalik to point its jaws at its prey when space was too cramped to maneuver its whole body. But it was the fins that provided the team with the most exciting evidence. Behind the spiny rays, there were lobe-like stumps like those of the coelacanth. But Tiktaalik's bones revealed a pattern that was much closer to the basic structure of limbs.
We learned a lot about the fin of Tiktaalik from this specimen. Now, this is a cast of all the different bones that we found in association, including the shoulder girdle here. But that is the complete fin skeleton from the front fin. So I'm a lobe fin fish. Here is my front fin. We call it a limb now. But here is Tiktaalik's front fin. We've got a shoulder joint. And it's very important that there's a shoulder joint which is oriented a little bit laterally, a little bit down in Tiktaalik. Very different from an animal that's just swimming with its fin and paddling along. This fin seemed to be oriented beneath the body. So this is the humerus. We all have a humerus. That's the first bone in the front appendage. We have a ulna and a radius. So you and I, all limbed animals, have an ulna and radius. We have some wrist bones, and we actually then have something which, like a wrist, could bend together and allow this fin to sit down and to contact a surface with a surface area. And so when we see all of these features, we see a structure which is very much like our limbs. So here is a fish using its fin in a very limb-like way.
Tiktaalik's heavy-duty fin still helped it to swim. But if it hit the shallows, the bones and joints would help to push itself up and punt around. But this new limb didn't just help mobility in the water. it became the driving force behind one of the most spectacular events in evolutionary history. The arrival of the first vertebrate animals on land. Over time, creatures evolved that spent most of their time out of water. They formed a new group we call amphibians. And to survive on land, they had to solve a new challenge. They had to be able to extract oxygen not from water like their fish ancestors, but from the air. Fish use gills to absorb oxygen into the body. In air, gills quickly dry out and stop working. China is the home of a rare and fascinating creature that can show us how the ancient amphibians overcame this problem. Today, the biggest amphibian alive is this creature, the Chinese giant salamander. It breathes partly through its skin, which has these long flaps on it, and that absorbs oxygen from the water. But it also breathes air. It's going to come up, and as it does, it snatches a gulp of air, blows a few bubbles, and sinks down again. Its jaw acts as a pump, forcing air down into the body. Here, oxygen is absorbed into the bloodstream from two inflatable sacs with permeable walls, lungs. Because they're enclosed inside the body, they don't dry out. The lungs it uses are just simple pouches coming from the back of the throat. But nonetheless, they were the first kind of lungs that animals had, the forerunners of the air-breathing organs that all of us land-living vertebrates now have. From their origins around 365 million years ago, the amphibians took on many different forms. Over 7,000 species now live in a variety of habitats, on land and in water. They include salamanders, frogs, and newts. But two things tied the amphibians to water. First, their skins are moist, and if they dry out, they die. And secondly, their eggs, like this frog spawn, are covered in nothing more than jelly, and they have to be laid in water, or at the very least, in moist conditions. And until the vertebrates could solve those two problems, they would not be able to colonize the dry parts of the land. Then a group of pioneers appeared with an amazing new feature to their bodies. We can find the evidence for this next step by looking at animals that can survive far from water today. This little creature is a lizard. They call it in these parts a tree dragon. And its body is very much the same shape as an amphibian. long body with the backbone and two pairs of limbs. But there's one crucial difference between an animal like this and an amphibian. Its skin is not moist, it's dry.
We can see what has changed by putting the two types of skin under the microscope. The skin of an amphibian is smooth with living cells visible on the surface. A lizard skin is much rougher because it contains large amounts of keratin, a protein similar to that from which our own fingernails are formed. Keratin-filled cells dry out and layer up to form scales. This creates a barrier, sealing water inside the body. We humans have inherited this keratin barrier in our skin, allowing us to maintain up to 70% of our bodies as water.
Animals with this body plan became a huge success. They evolved into a great number of species, big and small. We call them reptiles.
But the reptiles still had to overcome a second challenge: how to lay their eggs out of water. I have come to Lufeng in southern China to see evidence gathered by local scientists of the ingenious solution.
Thank you very much.
These eggs were laid by a reptile, and as you might imagine, a pretty big one at that. The first reptilian eggs almost certainly had a leathery covering, rather like those a turtle lays today. But these eggs are different. They have a hard covering, a shell. And you can see where the weight of the sand that eventually covered them and fossilized them bore down upon them. They crushed that shell, but the pieces are still in place. From examining modern reptile eggs, we know that this shell must have been made of hard calcium carbonate, and it must have supported an inner fibrous membrane. Together, they made the egg watertight. And that meant that the animals that laid them no longer had to go back to the water to lay their eggs, as all amphibians had to do. Instead, they could go to the driest part of the land and breed and nest and lay their eggs. So all the dry land was open to them. The amphibians had spearheaded the move to land. Now their descendants, the reptiles, were able to establish themselves in its driest parts. Over 9,500 species now inhabit our planet. But the limbs that helped the vertebrates emerge from the water began to present problems when it came to walking efficiently on dry land. Because they projected sideways, it took a lot of effort to hold their bodies off the ground. Then, around 230 million years ago, one set of reptiles developed an amazing solution.
These eggs were laid by an animal belonging to the most successful of all reptile groups, a group that dominated the world for 100 million years, the dinosaurs.
More than 150 different species of dinosaur have been found in the rocks of China alone, and over 1,000 worldwide. And they too depended on a crucial advance, a radical modification of the bone that connects the leg to the body, the hip. This is Lou Fungosaurus, a plant eater. The early reptiles had legs which splayed out from either side of the body and left the body very close to the ground. But a change in the shape of the hips of the dinosaurs enabled them to bring their hind legs underneath the body and so lift it up and give them greater freedom of movement. And some of them, including Lou Fungosaurus, were able to support the entire weight of the body on the hind legs. This new hip, along with sturdier leg joints, allowed the dinosaurs to take longer strides and support heavier bodies. They became the largest animals that have ever lived on land. But this new way of walking was also the first step on the road to an even more radical evolutionary advance. It was from this group of two-legged dinosaurs that there came a truly astonishing development that we are only just beginning to understand, and that was to lift the vertebrates to a completely new level. The backbone animals had colonized the seas and invaded the land. But there was one final habitat to explore, the skies. Another extraordinary Chinese fossil bed is providing the missing evidence for one of the great mysteries in evolutionary science: the intriguing link between dinosaurs and birds. I'm heading for Liaoning province to fulfill a long-held dream and see the site of these discoveries for myself.
These rocks are about 125 million years old. At that time, this part of China was tropical and the land was covered with a lot of freshwater lakes. And in those lakes was washed sediment, which formed these bands here. But every now and again, the sediment changes color. And that is ash that was spewed out from a nearby volcano. So that about that level there, there were a lot of skeletons awaiting to be discovered. And when they were discovered, they revealed some sensational facts about dinosaurs, the most sensational for a very long time.
This fossil was one of the most remarkable to emerge, a two-legged dinosaur about the size of a cat. It's been named Cynosauropteryx. Its discovery revealed an intriguing feature never seen before on a dinosaur. Up its tail and down its back, a covering of what looks like fur. Fresh finds have revealed that a wide range of two-legged dinosaurs had skin covered by very similar hair-like filaments. But what were they for? In Beijing, there are the crucial specimens that answered those questions. This is one of the world's leading institutions in the study of dinosaur evolution. Professor Xu Xing and his colleagues have been analyzing another larger specimen of Cynosauropteryx. It too retains traces, just fragments of the mysterious filaments.
If you look at near the tail, the dark things there near the tail,
they are single filaments,
just like our hair,
which are very, very simple.
Xu Xing has been puzzling over their function. Together, these filaments create a covering like fur. So the most likely answer is that they serve to keep these dinosaurs warm. But detailed examination has suggested an additional and very different function.
experts at the Institute have taken minute samples and examined them under powerful magnification. They contain intriguing structures. Some are lozenge-shaped, some spherical. Investigators identified them as melanosomes, microscopic capsules that contain pigment. They would have given the filaments on Cynosauropteryx's tail color.
Based on our analysis, you see stripes, white, brown.
Really?
Yes, definitely it's a beautiful pattern. Of course you can see, oh, that's maybe for display or communication or...
Do we know how it held its tail?
Tails definitely can move in different directions. Yeah. And in most cases, I guess, is up or horizontal.
So it's like a ring-tailed lemur waving its tail around as a display. Dinosaurs may have used these colored furry bands to signal to other members of the species or to act as camouflage. But then came a discovery that suggested another, far more significant function. I have been granted privileged access to the underground vaults of the Beijing Museum of Natural History to look at one of the most important creatures yet to be found in the fossil beds of Liaoning. This is Anchiornis, a creature that's clearly a dinosaur. It's got powerful legs here, ending with toes with sharp claws on them. And its head, which has been detached, lies here upside down, but you can see the jaw, which has teeth in them. But what is spectacular about this particular specimen is the perfection of the preservation of these structures. They show that the simple filaments have developed into something far more complex. The central stalk has tiny strands branching out on either side. The filaments have become feathers. Analysis of them has shown that the crest here on the head was a rufous red color, and the body feathers were striped black and white. There are feathers all down the legs. And looking at the density of them on the forearms here, it does look very like a wing. So the question is, could this animal fly? Could this be the moment when a dinosaur became a bird? A clue to the answer could come from the environment in which it lived. At this time, this area of northern China was covered in lush forests. Animals that could climb trees would be able to collect food that was not available on the ground. They could also find safety from ground-living predators. Xu Xing and his colleagues see evidence that Anchiornis adapted to a tree-living way of life by putting its feathers to a new use.
Anchiornis has some features suggesting tree-living lifestyle. For example, you look at their Anchiornis toe, they have very curved claws. And also they have big feathers attached to their feet. If Anchiornis is a tree-living animal, then you have a good reason to believe that flight starts from tree down, which means the bird's ancestor can take advantage of gravity and then start their journey to the sky.
Because Anchiornis lived high up, it could use its feathers
to glide. It must have needed all the feathers growing along its front limbs, hind limbs, and tail to create a large enough surface to catch the air and slow its descent. It wasn't capable of flapping flight, but at 160 million years old, it's now the earliest creature we know to have used feathers to fly. The gliding dinosaurs would eventually give rise to a whole new group of vertebrates, the birds. Over 9,000 species crowd our skies today. An astonishing evolutionary journey had enabled the vertebrates to dominate every corner of the planet. It was a journey that began in the Cambrian seas over 500 million years ago, and that led to the development of a set of body parts that we ourselves would ultimately inherit. Jaws and a bony skeleton from the early fish. Limbs and lungs from the amphibians. Watertight skin from the reptiles. By the time the birds appeared on the planet, the early pioneers of another major vertebrate group had also evolved. At first, they were tiny, but they were destined eventually to dominate the Earth. They were the mammals.
Most, I dare say, were little better than snack food for the dinosaurs, but all that was about to change.
A devastating meteor strike that many believe triggered a mass extinction.
We don't know exactly what happened, but certainly 65 million years ago, all the dinosaurs disappeared. But some of the birds and mammals survived. And with the bigger dinosaurs gone, the world was up for grabs.
Next time, I'll be investigating the extraordinary rise of the mammals to discover how they developed a remarkable set of new bodily features to become the most complex and successful vertebrates yet. Powerful senses, a radical new way of producing their young, and monstrous bodies. We will also see how we humans finally arrived on the Tree of Life, with hugely advanced brains that would allow us to outcompete all other species on the planet.
How did the meerkat cross the road? Stephen Fry pops the question to Catherine Ryan, Josh Whittacombe and Phil Jupitus next on BBC Two in QI.